My name is John Hughes. I'm an editor for Bloomberg's First Word. That's the breaking news desk for Bloomberg News here in Washington. I am also president of the National Press Club. I'm so happy that this event is happening today at the club, which is the home of the world's leading professional organization for journalists. We fight for a free press worldwide. It's one of our top priorities at the National Press Club. Another reason why it's so important that this event is being held here today. We were extremely active in the James Risen case, and in 2012, we gave Risen one of our highest honors, the John Aubuchon Press Freedom Award. And of course, for Risen and other journalists to do their jobs, they need information, they need sources, they need people to tell them what is going on. And here we are today in another matter tied to the Risen case here in 2015, still talking about it. But that is why it's fitting that this is the venue for the news conference about whistleblower Jeffrey Sterling. So I want to welcome you here today. And in particular, I want to welcome Jeffrey's wife, Holly, thank her for being here today. And I want to, again, thank all of you for being here. And I want to thank you for holding this important event here at the National Press Club. And with that, I'm going to hand it over to Norman. Thank you.
Well, I'd like to welcome you to the news conference today, which is co-sponsored by Expose Facts, a program of the Institute for Public Accuracy, also Reporters Without Borders, and also RootsAction.org. I should mention at the outset that while each so-called whistleblower case, in legal terms, is unique with some unique aspects, there are common threads to government policy and prosecution that need to be addressed. We call Jeffrey Sterling a whistleblower because it's incontrovertible, and I sat through the entire trial and nobody questions, that he went to the Senate Intelligence Committee with concerns and information that he had gained as a case officer at the Central Intelligence Agency. So really, nobody can question that Jeffrey Sterling is a whistleblower. He met with the Senate Intelligence Committee staff in early 2003. At the same time, when the long prosecution of Jeffrey Sterling went to trial in January of this year in federal district court, he maintained and continues to maintain to this moment, as he's now in prison, that he's innocent of all the charges that he provided classified information to James Risen that went into his book published in 2006, State of War. We have a number of speakers here, and in the interest of time, and I should have mentioned I'm I don't know if I mentioned my name, Norman Solomon, a coordinator of Exposed Facts as well as RootsAction.org. But I should say that in the interest of time, I'm not going to go through reading out people's biographies. This sheet that you have that says News Conference Thursday, October 15th, has biographical information in the sequence of the speakers. So we will hear from each person seated at the table, and then we certainly are going to leave time for Q&A. So without further ado, Jesselyn Radack.
Good morning. I'm Jesselyn Radack, and I head the Whistleblower and Source Protection Program at Exposed Facts. I do not represent Jeffrey Sterling, but I do represent half a dozen other whistleblowers investigated, charged, and prosecuted under the Espionage Act. The Obama administration has presided over the most draconian crackdown on national security and intelligence whistleblowers in U.S. history. The Justice Department has used the antiquated Espionage Act as a bludgeon to threaten, coerce, silence, and imprison whistleblowers for alleged mishandling of classified information. Meanwhile, powerful and politically connected individuals accused of the same and much worse conduct receive, at most, a slap on the wrist, like General David Petraeus, who gave away more secret information classified at a much higher level to his mistress and received a sweetheart plea deal for a minor misdemeanor. Or Hillary Clinton. She got a primetime TV apologist political spin interview from President Obama himself, and she will likely be our next president. Sterling's conviction is a gross miscarriage of justice. The Espionage Act has become a strict liability law, meaning that the prosecution does not have to prove that the whistleblower had any intent to harm the United States or benefit a foreign nation. Worse, Sterling's conviction is based on flimsy circumstantial evidence that almost certainly would not result in a conviction except under the very vague and overbroad Espionage Act. Taking a step back from the criminal trial that brought us here today, and putting aside Jim Risen's book and anything written there about the botched CIA program that gave rise to the Iranians' nuclear intelligence, I would like to remind everyone that Jeffrey Sterling is a whistleblower. Sterling is a whistleblower because in 2003, he met with staff from the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence, a proper internal political channel that we're always hearing people shout about. And he made reports about what he saw as a botched CIA operation. Basically, it's hard for me to talk about this because it's so difficult to see yet another person punished in this kind of way. But Sterling's case is very reminiscent for me of a lot of my NSA clients, and especially Tom Drake, who you will hear from in a few minutes. But Tom Drake, Bill Binney, Kirk Wiebe, Ed Loomis, they also used internal government channels to report misconduct. In fact, Tom Drake also reported his concerns to the Senate Intelligence Committee, the same one that Sterling went to. And they also became the targets of a federal criminal leak investigation for a news story by Jim Risen that they had nothing to do with. Making clear that punishing whistleblowers is a backdoor way of punishing journalists, the Justice Department used a subpoena 3 times on reporter Jim Risen to dangle a sword of Damocles over the heads of both Jim Risen and Jeffrey Sterling for nearly a decade, and argued vociferously against any sort of legally protected reporter source privilege. In these attacks on the press, too often, the forgotten victims, unfortunately, are the whistleblowers like Sterling. I urge President Obama to grant him a pardon. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Thomas Drake.
What we have in the Sterling case is an absolute travesty of justice. Apparently in this country, national security reigns supreme. It trumps everything. The primacy of national security gives the elite and those in privileged positions of power no accountability. It gives them immunity from any attempt to hold them responsible. And yet we have an administration that has no problem licensing unto itself the authorization to leak to the press on an extraordinary level. In fact, leaking highly classified sources and methods for political purposes and to present themselves in the best possible light. And yet, if you go to an Intel committee, which provides oversight on the secret side of government, or if you dare go to the press or have any contact with the press at all, under any circumstances, then you'll be charged with espionage. But the last time I checked, real spies don't go to the press. Real spies go to other spies. Real spies don't make public their secrets. I think it's a really important distinction to make here. And yet this administration has continued to use the bludgeon of the Espionage Act, a World War I era statute, to go after whistleblowers and truth tellers. And not only do they go after them in the Espionage Act, it's selective, it's malicious, and it's vindictive. So the problem, and of course, if you're the government, you know this, they don't like to admit it, but they will say it when necessary. If you're charged with espionage, there's no public interest defense. If you go to the Oversight Committee and we decide you might have given something to them that we don't like they gave to them, even though they have oversight responsibilities, that's no defense either. So here you are practicing the First Amendment redress in the public interest, and you find yourself criminalized. And that's what's happened in this country. Parallels between the Sterling case and what happened to Jeffrey and what happened to me are extremely close. Their investigation of me went over many, many years, as it did with Jeffrey Sterling. I myself went to the intelligence committees. I blew every whistleblower channel that existed under every statute and act. And yes, I did have contact with the press in the public interest. And yet we have what the government would say is simply individuals like myself and Jeffrey Sterling who have personal grievances, that what we did violated our signatures we signed, violated agreements we signed with our respective intelligence agencies. I also used to work at the CIA, so I had non-disclosure agreements myself. Oh, they can't be used for cover or violation of law or statute. And so here we are. But I just like to raise a couple of things that are extraordinary between my criminal case and Jeffrey Sterling's case. He was often forgotten, in some cases tragically so, even by the press, because of Risen. And recognizing that Risen ultimately did report a number of things, did have sources, but it's the sources are the ones that are taking the real brunt of the unprecedented attack against the press, against freedom of information, and particularly against anybody who dare expose government wrongdoing and malfeasance in the public interest. And it's an extraordinary double standard. But the chief prosecutor in my case was also the chief prosecutor in the Sterling case, William Welsh. Rather checkered history, but he made a claim and an attempt in my case, which was really a foreshadowing of what happened in the Sterling case. And he tested the judge in my case, threatening to bring the reporter into the courtroom. Now, in my case, the judge would have nothing to do with it. He said, we're not going to go down that deep, dark hole. In the Sterling case, Judge Brinkman said, yes. She allowed the subpoenas to happen, although in the end, Risen did not have to actually be forced or attempted to force to testify in Sterling's case. Eyewitness. The allegation was made by the chief prosecutor, Welsh, that Risen was the only eyewitness to a crime and that that criminal was Jeffrey Sterling. They were never able to actually prove it in the courtroom. But it's an extraordinary double standard because the former Attorney General of the United States of America, Eric Holder, I'm going to quote, in saying what happened to Sterling, quote, the defendant's unauthorized disclosures of classified information compromise operations undertaken in defense of America's national security. The disclosures placed lives at risk. Parenthetical insert. Chief prosecutor in my case said that what I did endangered the lives of American soldiers and that I had blood on my hands. I continue with the Holder quote, and they constituted an egregious breach of the public trust by someone who had sworn to uphold it. As this verdict proves, it is possible to fully prosecute unauthorized disclosures that inflict harm upon our national security without interfering with journalists' ability to do their jobs. Anybody see the Democratic debate the other night and things that Clinton said about Snowden? This is a Secretary of State, one of the most targeted individuals by other intelligence agencies and entities in the world, using a private server to traffic in highly sensitive information, and no doubt including classified information, and no doubt information including sources and methods. But hey, I'm Secretary of State. Even Obama gave her cover. This is what's happened in this country, an extraordinary double standard. And the last thing Hillary Clinton is a whistleblower. All for political purposes. So you have, in my case and in Jeffrey Sterling's case, we bear the full punishment. We bear the burden of the politics of outright and abject personal destruction. We as sources, whether to hold up a mirror to those things in government that are wrong, that violate the law, that actually are in fact endangering our national security, we're the ones that pay the high price. We're the ones that are put up on the altar of national security as sacrifices. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Holly Sterling.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here today. I'm here on behalf of my husband, Jeffrey Sterling. And really, I just want to tell you about Jeffrey, the real Jeffrey, not the person that the government has portrayed him to be. And also to let you know that I did write an open letter to President Obama asking for his immediate pardon. So Jeffrey was born and raised in Cape Girardeau. He was the youngest of six boys raised by a single mother. And he had aspirations to be a great person from early on in his life. He went to high school, immediately went to college at Millikan University, had a degree in political science, and then went on to Washington University and pursued a Juris Doctorate. It was in his third year of law school where he had seen a advertisement to travel the world and serve your country, which three of his brothers had done in the military, and he wanted to follow in their footsteps. So with that, Jeffrey immediately went home and started the process to become a case officer with the CIA. while he was working at the public defender's office, he actually was informed that the CIA wanted to hire him. And so he became a case officer and pursued his dream. Jeffrey, shortly as he was working there, was doing a great job until approximately about 2007, when he was supposed to have his first overseas post. It was at that time, right before he was leaving, his supervisor came to him and said, "We've given it to another person." Jeffrey asked why. He wasn't given an answer, except that they had felt that he would actually stick out as a big black man speaking Farsi. So to that question, Jeffrey asked, "At what point did you notice that I was black?" And "You taught me how to speak Farsi." So dismayed and very upset, he was going to go to another post. He went there for a while, but unfortunately, they did not give him proper cover nor the supports to be productive and perform his job as a case manager. He soon returned back to the United States and decided that he had had enough, that he wasn't able to successfully do the job that he was hired to do. And he filed a discrimination suit against the agency. He was the first black African-American male to file a suit against the agency. And that is really the start of everything that happened and where we're at now. Subsequently, Jeffrey was fired from his job. After he was fired, basically he was blackballed. He could not find work anywhere. He lost everything. He sold his possessions. He gave his two cats to a neighbor to take care of, got in his car, and made his way back to St. Louis, sleeping in his vehicle. He was lucky enough to get together with an old college friend who had just had a baby, and Jeffrey became the caretaker of that child in exchange for room and board. So here's a man that has a Juris Doctorate and was working for the CIA, and now he's taking care of a newborn baby. That's when I had the pleasure of meeting him, actually. It was in 2004 that he had finally secured a position as a health insurance fraud investigator. And Jeffrey and I had met. We met on Match.com, had two dates, and said we were going to get married on the beach barefoot. It was love at first sight. So Jeffrey excelled at his job at WellPoint as a health insurance fraud investigator. He received many accolades. He single-handedly found a Medicare fraud case in Florida that was about approximately $32 million and went and testified and had the conviction of the nine individuals that were responsible for that. On top of that, he was the ambassador of the United Way Giving for his company. He was in great standing. He was doing well. He was moving his way up in the company. Shortly after those events had happened, he had a knee replacement surgery, was on medical leave, and his boss had called him to ask him to come to work while still on medical leave. Jeffrey went to the office, still using a cane, and shortly after his arrival, he was arrested by the FBI. Not only did his company helped orchestrate him to come to the office so that Jeffrey could be publicly humiliated and arrested there instead of coming to our home, knowing he's on medical leave and no threat. That was on January 6, 2011. And he was then taken to Virginia in jail for approximately a month. Judge Brinkema did not give him the choice to come home. We went to court, and we have wonderful friends that we stay with here, and asked our friend to come up to the podium and basically said, can Jeffrey Sterling live with you? And she said, well, I think he would like to go home with his wife. And she said, I'll put it to you this way. It's either Mr. Sterling stays with you or he goes back to jail. Which one are you going to have? Of course, she graciously said yes. Jeffrey stayed here till approximately May, and then he was allowed to come home. He was subjected to taking drug screens, even though he has no history of substance abuse. So we basically lost everything. He was not able to get a job, although that was part of his condition, that he had to get a job. That was part of his release condition. So he tried and had to report to them all of the jobs that he was applying for. It was rejection after rejection. Subsequently, so Jeffrey's never worked since his arrest date on January 6, 2011. We were originally supposed to go to trial in October of 2011. And on the eve of that trial, William Welch, for some reason, the government could not go forward with their trial. So we went back home and waited. No answers, wondering what was going on. Well, what was going on was they were trying to get Risen to testify, and that's when it did become the Risen case. We went to the oral arguments, and Mr. Ed McMahon, Jeffrey's attorney, announced that Jeffrey was there present. Prior to the announcement, the government stated that Jeffrey Sterling was one of the most dangerous men in our country. When Mr. McMahon got up, he said, Your Honors, I would like to let you know for the record that Mr. Sterling, one of the most dangerous men, is standing here right next to me. The courtroom erupted into laughter over that statement. Jeffrey, myself, nor our lawyers thought that was really funny. It was actually a tragedy. He's been made basically to be a public spectacle. Excuse me, I get a little emotional talking about this. So we went on with our life waiting for the trial to come. The trial came, and as many as has stated that there really was absolutely no evidence that Jeffrey had done this. We never hid the fact that Jeffrey and Mr. Risen did speak. It was in 2002 that he covered Jeffrey's discrimination suit. And his discrimination suit actually was not dismissed until 2005. So they did have a history of speaking from 2002 to 2005. That was completely disclosed. On the witness stand, the main FBI agent, Ashley Hunt, admitted during cross-examination, she has no emails, she has no telephone recordings, she has nothing that can solidify or prove that Jeffrey had reported any classified information to James Risen. In fact, she said, I have just speculated that Jeffrey did this. In addition, there was a CIA manager that had made it known that there were over 90 additional people that were briefed on Operation Merlin that could have been the person that leaked the information. Not one of those individuals was investigated ever. It was solely Jeffrey. So with that, unfortunately, somehow a jury found Jeffrey guilty on all charges. And he was sentenced to 3.5 years in prison. During the sentencing hearing, it was requested that Jeffrey be placed in a facility close to home. On a Thursday, we received a letter. On a Tuesday, we needed to report to the facility. That facility is in Inglewood, Colorado, 900 miles away from our home. So not only has Jeffrey's life been destroyed, he hasn't had a job since January 6th of 2011. I'm a social worker. I love my job, but I don't do it for the money. We do not have savings. We do live paycheck to paycheck. In fact, we've relied on friends and family to get us back and forth to Virginia for the years of going to pre-trials, hearings and then for the hearings. And now, yet again, I have to rely on the goodwill of people to be able just to go see my husband. I've been able to go 3 times, and it's heart-wrenching to go see him there. He doesn't belong there. He's in with rapists. He's in with murderers. He's in with child molesters. These individuals, although it's a minimum security facility, have been in prison so long, 20, 25 plus years, that they've worked their way, due to good behavior, down to being in minimum security. Most of them, unfortunately, do not have education. Most of them cannot read. Most of them cannot write. And Jeffrey knows this because he is employed as a tutor there. And he's trying to help them obtain a GED. However, if you can't read or write, how are you supposed to be able to take a GED? As I said earlier, Jeffrey was a lawyer. He lost that. In the facility, he is being made to take continuing education classes. On my last visit, he said, I learned some new skills. I said, I'm almost afraid to know what those are. We try to bring some comic relief in once in a while. He said, you'd be very proud of me, Holly. I know what a checking account is. I know what a savings account is. And I know what a loan is now. And I know how to secure all those things. And I said, well, that's great, because I didn't really want to have to teach you that when you got home. He also had to take a critical thinking class. 12 hours he was supposed to study. At about 2.5 hours, he said, I'm done. Took the test, handed it up to the instructor. They said, you didn't do 12 hours. He said, I studied this ad nauseum, probably middle school, beginning of high school. I'm going to take the test. If I get a quarter wrong, I'll take your study for 12 hours and take the class again. Well, he's never heard anything back. So what does that mean? He got 100%. So one of the other things about having to see Jeffrey is, unfortunately, it's a blessing that I get to see him. I do get to sit next to him. It's not behind glass with a telephone. But for that privilege, he has to be strip searched before and after our visit. Here's a man that is intelligent, is caring, is the love of my life. And for over 10 and a half years, the government has just come down on him. And it was solely because, first of all, he had the audacity to stand up for his rights as a human being. And they didn't like it. Because unfortunately in this country, if you're not Caucasian, you're still no one. And then that just fueled the fire for when Jeffrey was able to have Mr. Risen cover his discrimination case. Of course, where were they going to go to? The supposed disgruntled black man that sued the CIA. And I'd like to touch on the fact that this was selective prosecution. As Thomas Drake had mentioned about General Petraeus, if you honestly looked at the two cases, my husband of what he was had allegedly done and what General Petraeus admitted to doing, if you remove it and look at it in paper, you take away the fact that you know one person is Caucasian, one person is African American. You take away that one person lives a very modest lifestyle, the other person has lots of money. You take away that the other person is a normal Joe Blow, and the other person has political clout. If you look at that, you see that General Petraeus committed far more egregious acts than what Jeffrey had allegedly done, and he did it for himself. While Jeffrey went to the Senate Select Committee because he was concerned about the citizens of our country and what this possible Operation Merlin could have done. So, with General Petraeus' punishment and Jeffrey's punishment, it's basically stating saying that the thought in this country is if you are a Caucasian person and you do wrong, that you don't need to be punished for it, and you get a slap on the wrist. Well, if you're a man of color, you are guilty until proven innocent, and you belong behind bars. So I'm just here today to let everyone know, really, the true story behind everything else that, you know, has not been out there. That Jeffrey is a wonderful man. To this day, he still says he wished that he was not discriminated against because he loved his job at the CIA and he loved serving his country, even after everything that they have done to him. He can still say that. So at this time, I would like to just read a couple excerpts from the letter that I wrote to President Obama. The first one is, Mr. President, I ask you to explain how this unfathomable sequence of events has been allowed to continue for over a decade. Does the government have no shame in destroying one man's life and wasting tens of millions of dollars of taxpayers' money to punish a man who had the audacity to do two things? Stand up for his constitutional rights and utilize proper channels provided to him to express concern for the citizens of our country. I am deeply saddened by our lives' events that Jeffrey and I have suffered and endured. You publicly committed to a transparent government led by your administration, yet it has been shrouded in mistruth and secrecy. Since you have started your push this summer to commute prison sentences for nonviolent offenders, will you not extend the same courtesy to an innocent man in prison? The second one is, how do you explain the obvious disparate treatment of General Petraeus? The Nobel Peace Prize laureate Archbishop Desmond Tutu wrote a letter to Judge Leona Brinkema this spring, stating equality under the law as a cornerstone of justice is significantly at stake in the sentencing of Mr. Sterling. While I realize that no two cases are identical, the fact remains that charges akin to those for which Mr. Sterling was convicted have in recent years resulted in extremely disparate penalties. And lastly, President Obama, this is your opportunity to show Jeffrey, our country, and the world what it means to be a true leader by acknowledging a grave injustice has been done and making amends. This can only be accomplished by granting Jeffrey Alexander Sterling an immediate pardon. Thank you for listening.
Our next speaker is Delphine Halgand.
Thank you, Oli, for being here with us and for sharing the true story, your true story of Jeffrey, and for being here to fight for him today. Thank you to all of you for being here today. Actually, as you know, Reporters Without Borders is a press freedom organization, the largest press freedom organization defending journalists all over the world since 1985. As an organization that defends press freedom, that defends freedom of information, we are extremely concerned by the precedent set in the United States government case against Jeffrey Sterling. Jeffrey is now in jail for merely talking to a journalist. He was sentenced based only on circumstantial evidence. The evidence that formed the basis of his conviction consisted only of multiple emails and telephone conversation between the two men, James Risen and Jeffrey. Without any content to directly prove Jeffrey was the source, the content of most of his emails and phone conversation remains unknown. Only the metadata have been made public. Here is Reporters Without Borders' main concern. The DOJ built a case against Sterling based entirely on circumstantial evidence and obtained his conviction in what the BBC called a trial by metadata. How is it possible that proving the simple existence of contacts between a former CIA operative and a journalist is sufficient to convict someone of espionage? Is a relationship with a reporter the new catalyst for government prosecution of whistleblower, whether alleged or actual? If anybody can be sentenced in the United States just because he was merely talking to a journalist on a regular basis, where is press freedom heading in the country of the First Amendment? Actually, after the verdict, Attorney General Holder said, I guess we quote him a lot today, as this verdict proves, it is possible to fully prosecute unauthorized disclosure that inflict harm upon our national security without interfering with journalists' ability to do their jobs. I'm sorry, but I disagree. It is really clear that the DOJ chose to make an example of Jeffrey, to warn government employees against talking to journalists. Leaks are the lifeblood of investigative journalists in this country, given that nearly all information related to national security is considered secret and classified. In fact, the war on whistleblower is designed to restrict all but officially approved version of events. The United States has witnessed an alarming trend in curtailing freedom of information these recent years. And as we heard earlier, President Obama, as we call it, war on whistleblowers, played an important role in this decline. Today, I'm here as the US Director of Reporters Without Borders to stand with Jeffrey and support him in his effort to appeal his conviction. And I'm here to stand with Holly to request a presidential pardon. Thank you.
And our last speaker before Q&A is Ray McGovern.
Just want to say, is this okay? Just want to say, first of all, what a privilege it is and what an honor to be sitting here with these four courageous people, some of whom I've known for a while, and one of whom I just met this morning. Holly, it's good to see you again after sitting through that very painful experience at the trial. I have never been more embarrassed for what has been called the Department of Justice, but I think you would all agree we should call it the travesty of justice, or maybe the Department of Vindictive Retribution. How about that? DVR. Now, I'm looking to my left here at two people who have been the subjects par excellence of vindictive retribution, as well as Jeffrey, Holly's husband. Jesselyn and Tom can speak volumes about this, and probably some of you don't know because it hadn't been mentioned today, but Jesselyn was the first whistleblower in the Department of Justice. She was a model for the rest of us because she wouldn't stand firm. She wouldn't acquiesce in the first person who was tortured, who happened to be an American citizen. His name was John Walker Lind, and so she left the Department of Justice in a way that you could read about in Newsweek. Now, we've talked a little bit about metadata, also called circumstantial evidence. It was last year, May, the former NSA General Counsel, Stuart Baker, he said, I'll quote, metadata absolutely tells you everything about anyone's life. If you have enough metadata, you don't really need any content. Now, when that was quoted back to him, in the presence of General Hayden, who was head of NSA when he decided that he was empowered to diss the Fourth Amendment, General Hayden said, if you have enough metadata, you don't need any content. We kill people based on metadata. Well, we also imprison people based on mostly illegally acquired metadata. I had a chance to ask Robert Mueller in a public gathering, How do you feel about using what you call parallel reconstruction, where you collect data illegally and then you give it to police or FBI and say, hey, find out the other information that we could use in court? How do you feel about that? And he said, well, we were given special authorities over after 9/11, right? Special authorities. How about this fellow Hayden? He was, of course, referring to killing people via metadata using phone numbers. And he said, you know, it's a kind of, people get hung up, this is a quote from Hayden, people get hung up on what they call a targeted list of people. It's really like we're targeting not people, but we're just targeting cell phones. We're not going after people. We're going after their phones in the hopes that the person on the other end of that missile may be a bad guy. Travesty of justice? Eric Holder explaining due process? Oh, we do, it doesn't say judicial process. We do due process right here in the White House. Thank you very much. What has become of our legal profession? Travesty of justice. Now, when General Hayden was asked after James Risen, who, after all, with Jeffrey, is the bête noire of this whole exercise, right? He is, to quote what Henry Kissinger said about Daniel Ellsberg, James Risen, let's face it, is the most dangerous man in America. He has more sources in CIA than I knew when I worked there for 27 years, right? And the idea that he depended on one person to do this, well, you know, metadata is not enough. So what about Hayden? Well, right here at this press club, on the 23rd of January, 2006, when Jonathan Landy asked him, well, you know, the Fourth Amendment says probable cause. Hayden said, no, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. You can look it up, folks. Look it up. Hayden denied that the Fourth Amendment said probable cause. So these are the kinds of people we're up against. Now, I just try to be quick here and refer to this book here. This book and the one that followed it, when people get a book in the CIA from James Risen, they immediately turn to Chapter 9. Chapter 9 is Merlin, okay? Chapter 9 of the new one is what happened when Hayden decided he had the power to trash the Fourth Amendment. So Chapter 9 is where they turn first. Then they go to the index, like everybody in Washington does, to see if their names are mentioned, right? Okay, so do they hate James Risen? They hate him, as we used to say in the Bronx, they hate him from another movie already, you know? They hate him from all the things that he's been guilty of, that is practicing enterprising, honest, sincere journalism. And so this is one way of getting at anyone who might want to talk to James Risen. As has already been said, it's enough if you have a phone call into James Risen, well, they can construct, or they can reconstruct, or they can parallel reconstruct whatever they want to do with this travesty of justice that is now our Department of Justice. Last thing I'll say is that Julian Assange, why is it that the British authorities won't let him get an MRI? He may not be aware of this, but he's got a real bad shoulder. And the doctor said he needs an MRI. They won't let him leave the Ecuadorian embassy. That's our vassal, the British state, you know. The Ecuadorian foreign minister said, look, if you want, you can surround the car with 10,000 policemen. Let him go to the hospital. And I said, no, he's not going to the hospital. Why do they hate Julian Assange? Well, they hate him from lots of pictures, but one of them is he saved Ed Snowden, okay? Now, how was he able to save Ed Snowden? Because Ed Snowden was in Hong Kong, and Julian had all manner of contacts there, and he had a very reliable lieutenant, Sarah Harrison, there. Not only that, but he was in Hong Kong because of Tom Drake. And he told us, when the three of us were there with Colleen Rowley, that it was Tom Drake's example, the 4 years of persecution that he went through at the hands of the Department of Injustice, that persuaded him, Ed Snowden, that he had to get a dodge if, number one, he was to achieve his mission, and number two, he was going to have any semblance of a chance to remain out of prison for the rest of his life. So my recommendation here is that we get Jeffrey Sterling to trade places with this fellow named William Welch and Eric Holder, put them behind bars where they deserve to be because of gross violations of our Constitution, which all of us here have taken a solemn vow to support and, what is it, support and defend. We all took that same vow. That's the vow that Ed Snowden took, and that vow dwarfs in significance any little promise that one made to protect classified information, lest, get this, it endanger the security of the United States. Endangering the security of the United States big time is violating the Constitution. Thank you very much.
We now have time for some questions. Yes.
Just quickly, I'm not sure it would be the best to ask. What's the status of the leak? Is there an appeal pending? Where is that? And is that sort of in some ways a better avenue to pursue than a pardon?
I can partly answer that. I don't know if you want to highlight.
Jeffrey Sterling did announce at the time after his sentencing in May that he would appeal. Glacial would be overstating perhaps the speed with which the U.S. government is willing to proceed on such appeals. But maybe, Holly, do you want to say anything more about that?
Yeah, we are appealing.
Yes, we definitely are appealing. I can't really speak to the specifics of it, but it is in the works for the appeal.
Yes. This is a question for Holly, and then also a separate question for others. What do you expect from the letter that you're sending to the president today? And then a question to Thomas and to Jesselyn. It's been reported that the FBI is looking into the Clinton emails. What do you expect from that? Do you expect anything at all from that?
I'm hopeful that President Obama will actually read the letter and learn that Jeffrey's innocent and what he did. He needs to be pardoned. But I want him to see the true man that Jeffrey is, that you've taken a wonderful individual that was taken out of our society. He was a productive member of society. He was a good man. He had never even had a traffic ticket before all of this. So I think it's a huge leap to say that because a journalist graciously reported on his discrimination case, that's a huge leap to then go say that he divulged classified information to him. So.
Circling back to your question for a moment, I would say that a pardon is vastly preferable to an appeal because appeals can take years and cost tons of extra money, whereas a pardon can be done in a snap, and it also erases the crime. In fact, I predict that General Petraeus will have a pardon before Jeffrey Sterling gets either a pardon or an appeal filed. In terms of what will happen with Hillary Clinton in the email investigation, I predict absolutely nothing. I think it'll be framed the way Bernie Sanders so politely for her took it off the table during the Democratic debate as being extraneous partisan noise. And like the last three directors of the CIA, Hayden, Brennan, Panetta, even though classified information at the highest levels was compromised, there will be no consequence at all. And I'm not advocating that Hillary Clinton should be tried under the Espionage Act. That's not what I'm asking for. What I'm asking for is it whistleblowers, not be?
The whole FBI thing is a charade, okay? I have no doubt in my mind what was on that server. And I think there may still be a lot more to come out. It's also highly political. There are those in Washington who do not want Hillary to be the candidate for president for the Democratic Party, and if they can derail her, good riddance, and let the Republicans, reascend the throne, as it were. But it's a kabuki dance, and you have to remember that the President of the United States has actually weighed in on this, although the White House attempted to walk it back, that there was no risk to national security in terms of what Hillary did with her server. No risk to national security. No risk to national security. And yet people like myself and Jeffrey Sterling, what we did, being charged with espionage, an extraordinarily grave crime to charge an American with espionage, was actually worse. I was told worse than being a spy because, hey, what you did was get it printed all over, right? So everybody gets to see it, including the spies. In terms of the pardon, I don't often talk about my case. Let's just say, and there are some that may be in this room that know this, and others outside this room, many attempts were made. Appeals were made, back channels, very senior levels. Obama would not even think about it, pardoning me, okay? And the other thing, it's just interesting, and this is where the extraordinary parallels, because we were both framed. We were framed, okay? Metadata is what quote-unquote did Jeffrey in. In my case, it was allegations ultimately that I was a ringleader for what? For providing information that disclosed the domestic mass surveillance program to the New York Times and James Rice and Eric Lichtblau. See the parallels? Same reporter, same outlet, right? And yet its sources or alleged sources. They had no proof, couldn't demonstrate any proof that I had any contact, in fact, in my case. So the character, I let others speak about the character of me. I can speak very powerfully about the character of Jeffrey. I have had communication with him before and after. And since he's been incarcerated, extremely and extraordinarily personal communication, because I can identify him so well. Because I came within this close of being in the same place he is. When I came up for my sentencing, they have to do this, they have to look at every record that exists on you. And when it was presented before the court and before the judge, there was a big zero on the paper. They couldn't find anything that I had violated in my entire adult life. And in fact, and this is a light moment because it's really to take away the sort of the heaviness of this, the judge said it's very rare for a defendant to come before me who has a better record than I do.
Can I follow on that question? Just something that you said earlier. What do you think is on the server? The Clinton server, you mentioned.
She's Secretary of State, you tell me. Everything that she ever did for 4 years, period. Okay? Speaking about metadata, what about the content? The content is king. That's what's rich. And it's just flagrant violation of all, even Department of State standards in terms of security practices, okay? And to think, although I've heard some people joke that her server might have been more secure than a Department of State system, and that was one excuse she could use, let's get real. Let's get real, right? I have a very technical background, quite familiar with what was used to set up that server in terms of just the basic technology, all kinds of holes, right? It's just, it's Hillary hypocrisy, right? And it was just on full display at the Democratic debate.
Tom, say a word about the retroactive classification of that paper.
Which paper?
The one that James Spanford had the
original. Oh, one of the injustices in my case, you talk about being framed, is where they will actually recast evidence that is actually unclassified and then make it classified under what they call the mosaic theory. So if you apply that same principle that was used against me, that was used against Jeffrey Sterling, or by the way, if you have a trash can on your desktop, that's one part of the Jeffrey Sterling case, and you happen to delete something in a trash can, that means you're obstructing justice. So I was also charged with obstructing justice, which had a charge of 20 years all by itself. So the retroactive classification is a very convenient way to then make what was unclassified classified and use that as a basis for a prosecution. Now, you tell under a mosaic theory, you take everything the Secretary of State, former Secretary of State Clinton ever did under mosaic theory, I think it would probably rise to the level of having violated the national security of the United States of America. Remember, she was not a whistleblower. She did that for political reasons. And never mind the Clinton Global Initiative.
We have time for I think three more quick questions, and then we can do individual interviews in the room. Yes, please.
Hi, my name is Andrei Sitov. I'm with the Russian News Agency Task here in Washington, D.C. Snowden was referenced a few times in the discussion and the debates, the democratic debates the other night. So my question basically is, can Mr. Snowden have a fair trial if he comes back?
One of his attorneys is here.
Hi, Mr. Snowden cannot get a fair trial in the United States if it's under the Espionage Act, because as I mentioned, it makes no distinction between whether you revealed information in the public interest for the purpose of educating the citizenry or whether you sold secrets to our enemies for profit. And until we get some negotiating going, which Snowden said the other day has not been happening, and until the Espionage Act is off the table, no, I don't think he can come back.
One last question, I'll keep it brief. Thank you to the panel, by the way. My name's Manny, Rob Ballone with RT. Talking about public outrage in this case, and this question actually may be best for Delphine, this was a very high profile case. There was a lot of extraordinary testimony within the trial period. Why do you suppose it didn't get the same high level coverage by more mainstream outlets, do you suppose?
First, I'm glad to see so many media here today. And Holly will be pretty busy doing many different TV interviews today, but I guess I don't have a precise answer to that. It's just my personal understanding. I guess it's a pretty complicated case, and it's maybe more complicated to understand that, oh, a New York Times journalist could go to jail. It's much more complicated. You have to put yourself into it to understand what are the real consequences and the, as I say, the dangerous precedent that such a case like Jeffrey put. So I guess I would say that I'm glad to see you all here and to put yourself into such a complex and dangerous precedent for press freedom in this country.
If I could take a really quick stab at that, Manny, thanks for the question. I think in general, the press has a much stronger constituency than whistleblowers. I mean, off the top of my head, we have Reporters Without Borders, who's here today, Freedom of the Press Foundation, CPJ. I mean, there's so many different outlets, and really, there are not that many whistleblower support organizations. That's one reason. I think another reason is because Jim Risen already was so high profile, and that ended up, for better or for worse, just taking a lot of the oxygen in the case. I mean, he got the 60 Minutes interview, the equivalent of what Tom Drake was able to have. Also, Jeffrey Sterling's case was taking place in the Eastern District of Virginia, which is the most conservative court in the country, before one of, in my opinion, the worst judges in our country, who absolutely would have come down on Jeffrey for media attention in a way that she came down on another client's, CIA client, John Kiriakou. Tom's case was in Maryland. totally different district, which was more amenable to that.
We just need to get that in the United States of America, national security is currently engaged in unamending the First Amendment. I just want to say that again. Unamending the First Amendment. It is the cornerstone. It is the foundation of the Bill of Rights and all of our liberties and freedoms. If you don't have the ability to do redress for grievances, if you don't have the ability to publish what is in the public interest, if you don't have the ability to inform people, if you don't have the ability to associate freely one to another, then what we call a constitutional republic, a special form of democracy, begins to erode and disappear. A passing thought in terms of the extraordinary parallels between my case and Jeffrey Sterling's case. When the FBI came to my house on November 28, 2007, so unceremoniously with a quote-unquote search warrant, during the course of their seizing my property, guess what book they took as evidence?
This is not rehearsed.
You have a right to read in this country. It's not a crime. So I'm not sure why that was on a search warrant.
Thank you for being here.